والصبح بدا من طلعته والليل دجى من وفرته فقر الرسل فضلا وعلا أهدى السبل لدلالته الصبح بدا من طلعته والليل دجى من وفرته فقر الرسل فضلا وعلا أهدى السبل لدلالته كنز الكرم مولى النعم هدي الأمم لشريعته أزكى النسب أعلى الحسب كل العرب في خدمته كل العرب في خدمته الصبح بدا من طلعته والليل دجى بوفرته فقر الرسل فضلا وعلا أهدى السبل لدلالته سعتي الشجر نطق الحجر شق القمر بإشارته جبريل أتى ليلة أسرى والرب دعا لحضرته والرب دعا لحضرته الصبح بدا من طلعته والليل دجى بوفرته ألا شرفا والله عفا عما سلفا من أمته فمحمدنا هو سيدنا فالعز لنا لإجابته فالعز لنا لإجابته الصبح بدا من طلعته والليل دجى بوفرته فقر الرسل فضلا وعلا أهدى السبل لدلالته الصبح بدا من طلعته والليل دجى بوفرته فقر الرسل فضلا وعلا أهدى السبل لدلالته أهدى السبل لدلالته.
Abdullah was taken to marry Amina, and they got married and spent about 3 days together in Medina with her family before he, Abdullah, returned with her to Makkah and settled there. There are a few questions, a few important points to touch on before we continue with speaking about Abdullah and Amina, such as Abdul Muttalib. His actual name, Abdul Muttalib's name, was Shayba. Shayba means white-haired. He was named this because he had a lock of white hair when he was born. Sometimes it's called Shaybatul Hamd. Shaybatul Hamd. The white hair of praise. Why was he then known as Abdul Muttalib? Because his father, Hashim, and his father Hashim was a trader, and he was known to be the one to start trading with the two seasons of summer and winter. لإيلا في قريش إيلا فيهم رحلة الشتاء والصيف. The journey of Shita, winter, and Saif, summer. He was known to be the one to start these trade routes. And more than that, his name too, his name was actually Amr. But he became known as Hashim. Hashim means the one who tears bread, the one who breaks the bread. Why? Because he's also known to be the first one to serve the pilgrims something resembling gravy, thareed, something precious, something tasty, besides just serving them dates and water and maybe slaughtering a cow or sheep or two. He would make a type of gravy and serve this to them. And for the gravy, he needed to have bread baked, and then he would tear of the bread, and that is called Hashim. And the one who does that is called the Hashim. Let's say he became known as Hashim. The one who... So it's a sign of generosity. And the clan of the Quraysh clan that Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born into, was known as the clan of Hashim. Banu Hashim. So it's significant you hear these terms. And Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is sometimes referred to as Al-Hashimi. The Hashimite prophet. Because he came from this clan. So where did the name come from? It was his great-grandfather who got this title or got this name. Hashim. Hashim, on one of his trade journeys, to Greater Sham, and the famous place, and we make dua for its people, Ya Rab, the famous place of Gaza, in Arabic known as Gaza, he is known to have passed away there. And one of his wives, her name was Salma, the mother of Shayba. She was not from Makkah. So Bakho Hajar. Hashim is the great grandfather. He started the trade routes, and all on one of his journeys he passed away in Gaza. His son was Shayba with a lock of white hair. Okay? This boy's mother, Salma, was not from Makkah originally. She was from Medina. She was a Khazraji. Oh, was in Khazraj? She was from Khazraj. So after Hashim passed away and the news reached there, she then returned to where? She went to her people in Medina. She went to her people in Medina with her son. So she took a young son. They say he was about 8 years old. 8 or 9. With me there, Haja? So he's still called Shayba. Shaybatul Hamd. Shayba and his mother Salma are in Medina. Who was his father? Hashim. Hashim passed away. Hashim was actually like a chief in Makkah before he passed away. He had seen to the pilgrims, and he was a huge businessman in Makkah. He would take of the Meccan goods and sell it there in Yemen and in Sham, and take of whatever he could purchase there and come sell it back in Makkah. One of his elder sons took charge of the business after he passed away. And that elder son's name was Al-Muttalib. Was also a son. So Shayba's brother. But Shayba was the baby, the younger of the siblings, and he was of the elder. He was not taking care and all now Rather. Pause. Al-Muttalib. Sorry. Was not his eldest son. Al-Muttalib was Shayba's brother. So he's an uncle of Shayba. Shayba was... Okay. Hashim. Okay, wait. Just restart. You know, last week, focus now. I'm looking too much at the ladies this morning. Hashim and Muttalib are brothers. Hashim is the chief, one of the chiefs of Makkah, taking charge. Hashim passes away. Salma and Shayba, mother and son, go to Medina. And Al-Muttalib, the brother of Hashim, takes charge. But as he is busy there, it's not his business, it was his brother's business. It's not his position as chief, it was his brother's position. So something bothers him. And after a while, he travels to Medina and speaks to Salma and says, I will take charge of your son. But I want to train him in business and train him in his father's position. So when he is mature enough, he can take his rightful place as his father's heir in the business and his father's heir as chief. Okay, now. So initially she hesitates. But afterwards, he convinces her and he travels to Makkah with his uncle Al-Muttalib. With me, Hajja? He travels on the same camel behind him. So he's a young boy. And he travels on the camel behind him and he enters Makkah. Al-Muttalib enters Makkah with Shayba on his back. And people say, see, Al-Muttalib maybe got a new slave there in what? In Medina. So they didn't realize it was Hashim's son. And they referred to him as what? A slave of Al-Muttalib. And that in Arabic would be Abdul Muttalib. So that's the point. So did that sink in? Is that the lesson of the morning? Can we take a breather then? Lots happened in the past week. Alhamdulillah, we're back safely. So his name is actually Shayba bin Hashim. Shayba ibn Hashim. Shayba the son of Hashim. But he's famously known as Abdul Muttalib. Shayba is Abdul Muttalib. And Abdul Muttalib is the one, after he had settled in Makkah, he's the one who had the dream of where the Zamzam pit was. And when he finally got it, he found the relics of the tribe of Jurhum, their forefathers there. And he is the one, Abdul Muttalib, who made dua that Allah must grant him 10 sons, and the youngest of which was Abdullah. He named him Abdullah. But he had said before, if Allah were to grant him 10 sons, he would sacrifice one of them. And then when they drew lots, the name, Abdullah's name was repeatedly pulled. And then when he found opposition from his wives, saying, no, you can't just do that. So then he consulted, and then he was advised that he draws 10 camels in place of Abdullah's name. And he must continue drawing 10 more and add 10 more until the arrow of the camels is pulled down. So, that whole incident. Now, if we go into the lineage, we know now where the term or the name Banu Hashim emanated from. The clan, Banu means the children of, the clan of Hashim. Hashim was the Nabi Muhammad's great-grandfather, Hashimiyya. And his name was Amr, but he became known as Hashim because of his breaking of the bread for the gravy for the pilgrims.
Sheikh, what kind of pilgrimage did they do at the time?
Yeah, Hajja, if Hajja was here last week, but okay, Hajja wasn't maybe, but the thing is, they were remnants, they were descendants of Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam. By Nabi Ismail alayhi salam. And there were certain things that they adhered to in their traditions and cultures that was drawn from Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam, but that they had amended. So one of which Hajjah, or few of which was, they revered the Kaaba. How did they come to revere the Kaaba? Because it was this understanding was passed on that it is the house of the ultimate being, the supreme creator. And then they also respected the sacred months, and they also adhere to an annual pilgrimage in the month which they call Dhul Hijjah. Dhul Hijjah literally means that which possesses the pilgrimage. Dhul Hijjah means that which owns the pilgrimage, or that in which the pilgrimage is to be performed. So the month is named, Dhul Hijjah is named the month of the pilgrimage. So the tawaf they would do, they would sacrifice, but they would sacrifice for the idols that they had brought in there. And tawaf also, like we said before, the Quraysh instituted that people should perform tawaf in clothing that they purchased from the Quraysh. And if they are unable to purchase this clothing, they should either perform tawaf naked, or if they were to perform tawaf in their clothing that they came in, they should remove it after the tawaf and never wear it again. So they modified things. So tawaf, they did, but with some modifications. They sacrificed. And then they initially stood on Arafah Hajjah for a particular period. But then later they felt themselves above the other pilgrims, the other Arabs that used to come in annually. And then instead of standing on Arafah with the rest of the pilgrims, those of the Quraysh who also now performed the rituals in that particular year, they would stand in Muzdalifah. So they modified these types of things. But it was a big, they understood its position. Besides revealing the Kaaba, they were granted the honor of being the custodians of the Kaaba. There was the covering of the Kaaba, there was the holding of the key of the Kaaba, and then there was the watering of the Hujjaj and the feeding of the Hujjaj. But it was a big annual season for them as well to make money. That's nice. So they wouldn't give it up for anything. But now one question some people ask, and I thought just important to mention, is where does the name Quraysh come from? So, we see Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib, ibn Hashim ibn Abdi Manaf, ibn Qusay ibn Kilab ibn Murrata ibn Ka'b ibn Fihr. One of the great grandfathers, his name was Fihr. And you can find the Nabi Muhammad's lineage on the net, even in English. Fihr. Most historians say that he was the one who had the nickname of Quraysh. Nickname of Quraysh. And because of this, they have an opinion regarding his height. They say he must have been a short man. Why would they say so? Because the Arabic students know that this scale of Fu'ail, is a diminutive form. It means something small. Like Jund, is an army. And if you put it on this scale, you get Quraysh, Jund, Junaid. Junaid means a small army. Junaid. And then like we said for the ladies last year, Zubd or Zubda means it means butter. So you put it on there, Zubaid. Zubaida means a small piece of butter. It's precious. Precious Hajjah in the desert. Precious. It changes the entire meal, isn't it? Nah. So Quraysh. Quraysh comes from the word Kirsh. Now here's something we've got to. He must have been small but sturdy. He must have been small but dynamic. He must have been small but powerful. Why? Because Kirsh means something of significance and power. To the extent that when the Arabs got exposed to the deep oceans, and they saw a shark for the first time. They had no word for the shark. They had no word for the shark. So they called it Samakul Kirsh. The shark of significance. The shark, oh, the fish, sorry. The Samak means fish. The fish of significance. The fish of power. You with me? And if you look at Kirsh backwards, what do you get? Shark. It's as if the English got it from the Arabic, but they just flipped it. It's our word. It's not their word. They just read it back to French. Kirsh shark. Kirsh. And in Egypt, the currency is junay, the pound. Egyptian pound. But the cents, like the smaller, yeah, is a kirsh, a penny. Because it's a powerful, part of the currency now. Kirsh. So, Quraysh would be the diminutive, the smaller form of Kirsh. So it simply means Something small but powerful. Something small but significant. Not to be overlooked. So he is known to have had that title of or nickname of Quraysh. And that's where the whole tribe became known as the Qabila of Quraysh. A link to him. It wasn't just a name made for the tribe. It was a name, a link to a man, an individual. Okay, good?
Come on.
Now, one significant question too. Because you are scholars. You find in certain history books the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's lineage. And they have his lineage up until Nabi Adam alayhi salam. Which is significant. Now two things we want to say here. Firstly, the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam's lineage is divided into three parts. It's him sallallahu alaihi wasallam alayhi salam until Adnan. And this part of his lineage, this is the first part. Him until Adnan, that is a confirmed lineage. Authenticated, there are no difference of opinion there, no options as to where it could have maybe branched off, etc., and re-linked. No, that's confirmed. From Adnan to Nabi Ismail alayhi salam, that's the second part of the lineage. And from Nabi Ismail alayhi salam until Nabi Adam alayhi salam, that's the third part of the lineage. These two, there are opinions regarding them. It was too far back. So they have something, but in what they have some difference of opinion too. So there are differences of opinions in certain names, or how they were expressed, or how they are to be documented. Same here, too far back. You have something, and it's there. And you find even certain historians saying this, this is the better one, this is the star. But it's okay, we don't need really to know, but it is there. They made attempts. This part is confirmed. This is the first note I need to make here regarding his lineage, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, the second note is this. And this he, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was spines and those wombs did not come together except in Allah's name. Not sifah. It was not out of wedlock. All along, from him to him, from Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, from there to there to there, there was no produce, progeny, descendant, except that he was born in wedlock. With me? And he says, Allah had chosen from the children of Adam. Allah had chosen certain times. Allah had chosen from Quraysh. Allah chose from Hashim. Allah chose me. فَأَنَا خِيَارٌ مِنْ خِيَارٌ I am the choicest of the choicest. And he would say these things وَلَا فَخْرَ without boasting. He would be informed to or instructed to inform us about this. So the point is whether that is confirmed or not or these opinions, he was informed by Jibreel alayhi salam or was instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to tell him, to tell us that there was no sifah here. Sifah, a promiscuity or things out of wedlock. Was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned by previous prophets? And was he mentioned, or is he was he mentioned in any of their books? There's a, if you go to the third juz, and you go to the second last side, Surah Ali Imran, top of the page, in the 13-line print. Allah says something there. And then the Mufassirun say it's all in relation to Rasulullah. Allah says, وَإِذْ أَخَذَ اللَّهُ مِثَاقَ النَّبِيِّينَ لَمَا آتَيْتُكُم مِّن كِتَابٍ وَحِكْمَةٍ ثُمَّ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مُصَدِّقٌ لِمَا مَعَكُمْ لَتُؤْمِنُنَّ بِهِ وَلَتَنْصُرُنَّ Allah says, Allah took a pledge with all the Anbiya, all the prophets from before. And the pledge was this. Along with whatever I give you of scripture and wisdom, I want you to take allegiance with me. beyond what I give you yourselves. Allah said to the prophets, beyond what I give you yourselves of scripture and wisdom, if a messenger were to come after you, but in your time, after I have sent you, but I send him, I draw you to take an oath and pledge that you will support him and you will follow him. Mufassirun say, that is understood here, is that it is in relation to Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the only prophet who will be granted the will be granted, he's already granted. Listen to me, what would you do if I told you that there's a Sahabi, someone who saw Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and someone who spent some time with him and believed that he was the final messenger and believes in Allah, obviously. He's a Sahabi who's still alive. Was alive. Living, never tasted death yet. Never died. Who?
Isa.
Yes. Isa alayhi salam. You believe he's alive. Allah says they didn't kill him. They didn't crucify him. Allah raised him. And he's to return. He's of the major signs of the end of time of this dunya. And on his hand, Dajjal will be killed. But on the Isra, the night journey from Makkah to Baytul Maqdis, Jerusalem, who did Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam meet there? He met all the Anbiya. And what did they do together? What did the best of humans want to do and decide to do and lovingly do when they got together? They didn't want to do anything but pray. And who did they have lead them in this prayer? Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they spent some time together, they interacted, they saw each other and all, and he saw them, and they had the honor of the space with him. And from them, all had tasted death. They were all, it's their souls. They were part of Barzakh, and Allah removed the veil between this dunya and that world. For him to see them, for them to interact with him, all had tasted death but one. Nabi Isa alayhi salam. So he got the honor. Along with the honor of prophethood, he got the honor of suhbah. Nabi Isa alayhi salam, Allah says in the Quran, he gave the glad tiding to his people. Surah As-Saff. If you go to Surah As-Saff in the 28th juz, I think it's chapter 60 or 61, Allah says, Nabi Isa alayhi salam said, O children of Israel, I am indeed a messenger to you. Ismuhu Ahmad. His name is the most praised. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I am da'watu Abi Ibrahim. I am the prayer of my father Abraham. And I am Bushra Akhi Isa. And I am the glad tiding of my brother Isa alayhi salam. The glad tiding we hear now here. Allah took a pledge with all the prophets that I'm giving you things, I'm instructing you with things, I'm endowing you with wisdom, but if another messenger, a special messenger were to come in your time, you would leave all that I've given you and you'll follow him. Nabi Isa alayhi salam is the only one who have been granted that honor. Because when he comes back, he's not going to return as a prophet, he's returning as a ummati of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then, Allah says in the Quran, he gave glad tidings to his people of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to come. And then you go back to Ahmad Didat, Allah Alhamu, his clips and his booklets and all those things, the Hajjah, like in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s, during apartheid, he was a powerful dynamic force to be reckoned with. He didn't fear anyone, for Allah's sake, he had all protection. And then he proves, in the Bible, Hajjah, you see those videos, those old VHS and Betamaxes we used to hire and buy, he proves in the Bible, in the New Testament and all, besides the Old Testament, this mention there of the praised one. And then Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I am the prayer of my father Abraham. The dua we know, the first dua we know, Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka anta as-sami'u al-alim, as said, you go to the end of the first juz, as said by Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam and Nabi Ismail alayhi salam when they were raising the foundations of the Kaaba. Allah says when they were raising the foundations of the Kaaba, they made this dua. But they also made two other duas. The second dua was, O Allah, make us truly those who are Muslim to you, ay, truly those who submit to you, truly those who offer peace to you, and make of our progeny also those who are Muslim to you, and show us our rituals and accept our repentance, etc. That's the second dua. Third dua, now Hajjah, think about this. There are certain Rabbanas in the Quran that we can't make. There are certain Rabbanas you can repeat, you can make. Generally, there are Rabbanas that Allah said certain Anbiya made, or certain people made, you can make them. But there are certain ones, for example, in the end of Surah Al-Ahzab, chapter 33, check there the end of chapter 33, Allah says, people will see each other in Jahannam. Allah protect us. Some people in Jahannam will see others. And then in Jahannam they will say, رَبَّنَا آتِهِمْ دُعْفَيْنِ مِنَ الْعَذَابِ. Oh Allah, oh our Lord, give them double punishment. Because they led us astray. أَضَلُّونَا. That's a رَبَّنَا. Jihad means, يَا رَبَّنَا مَاكِ. But now you see رَبَّنَا, you don't just see everything, anything that follows deserves to be repeated. Allah has informed you of what's to happen there. Likewise this one. There's three du'as Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam and Nabi Ismail alayhi salam made. The first two we can make, Rabbana taqabbal minna, and the other one, Rabbana waj'alna muslimin, you can make. Just change the form there from dual to plural if you want. But the third one we can't make. Allah documents Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam and Nabi Ismail alayhi salam making du'a that Allah must send a messenger amongst the progeny that will teach them scripture and wisdom, and it will purify them. You go to about verse 129 in Surah Baqarah. So Nabi Muhammad said, I am the prayer of my father Ibrahim. Okay, Hajjah? Significant. It just didn't happen yet. There was preparation for his arrival. Okay. Then a question regarding the year that he was born in, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is the Hijrah, Hajjah? And where does our calendar start? Our Islamic calendar. In which year are we? Islamic year. 1440. What does this signify? And you see a H here. It means Hijri. What does it signify? What happened 1,440 years ago? Yes, there was some travel from Makkah to Medina, and then he settled in Medina. Some people, I've already heard someone say, there was some became messenger. He became a messenger in the cave of Hira 1,439 years ago. Last year, something. No. You have to add 13 years. Because 13 years before the migration, that is when the incident in the cave occurred. This year is because this was a significant occurrence in the Prophet's life and in the lives of the first Muslim community in that Medina. With that migration, Medina became the capital of Islam. And only 8 years later, they sanctified and cleansed Makkah. So Makkah became a Darul Islam, but Medina was Medina. Al-Madina, the city. Al-Madina al-Munawwara, the illuminated city. What was it known as before the name Medina? Yathrib. And before the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's entry into Yathrib, it became known as Medina, it was known as a place of illness. People who weren't used to growing up there or living there easily got feverish and ill. And from the time he entered it, all that was removed. He came in, not only shayateen left, all the germs also left. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Naam, can you imagine his presence? He was amongst the man, but he was divinely connected. Innama ana basharun mithukum. I am but a human like you, but there's something else. Yuha ilay, but I receive revelation. He was a vessel for the final communication. The final communication that mountains could not take. Had we revealed this Quran to the mountains, it would split asunder. Nabi Sallam's heart contended. Naam. And he said, the hadith, he says, whosoever learns of Quran when they're young, hadith is in Tirmidhi, whosoever learns of Quran when they're young, then the Quran mixes, intertwines, gels with their flesh and their bones, with their DNA. Now, what about him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Anyway, that's something else. But now, yes, why are we here? Yeah, so we have the first year after the migration is year number one. Second year is year number two, etc. What about the time before the hijrah? The record was difficult. Years were not numbered. Now the Muslims were able to backtrack a bit. 2 years before the hijrah, 3 years before the hijrah, 5 years before the hijrah, etc. But before that, they would note and remember and highlight births by significant occurrences, by significant happenings. And that's why Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah decreed it such that something huge happened in the same year that he was to be born in, something so huge that it would be recorded for all of eternity and time, something so huge all the Arabs in the region came to hear about it, something so huge it was unheard of before. It became known as the year of the elephant, where Allah showed His divine intervention and protected the Kaaba. So you understand, you know this, that narrative from young. The only thing is, the man who came from Yemen was not the king of Yemen. He was a governor, and he was a Christian, and he was under Najashi, under the king of Abyssinia. Understand? But he had done his own assessment of the region, because he was now at the southern, Yemen is at the southern point of the Arabian Peninsula bottom. And he would see people from his area go and make the annual pilgrimage. And he saw the people visiting there, and he saw the business opportunity, Hajjah, the business opportunity. And he realized that the attraction there, higher up into the peninsula, is that house. That structure, it's attracting everyone. And those around it, those who are fortunate to be living there, they benefiting from this business. So he had something else built. He had something built, he had a church built, a grand thing built, and he called it Al-Qulais. And if you were to Google this, Hajjah, you will see some remnants there. They still have like a broken down structure, dilapidated structure of what was. He built this and he slowly wanted to draw people to it instead of the Kaaba. And he was still trying to devise a method, a plot, a way through which you could draw people to it instead of the Kaaba. But then what happened? One Arab, Hajjah, and the Arabs generally are hot-blooded. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was the total exception. Of all that he experienced, he was the one he was known to smile the most. And even on the battlefield, he prayed for his enemies. He was And when once he was walking with the Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha, and this is not in Medina, two Jews came from the opposite direction, and the Jews said, instead of saying Assalamu alaikum, the Jews said Assalamu alaikum. But she knew what they were saying, and Sam means death. Assalamu alaikum means death upon you. Nabi Sallam didn't respond, but she responded, she started scolding them. So Nabi Sallam calmed it down. So he told her, Rifq, gentleness is not found in anything illa zanahu, except that gentleness beautifies it. And gentleness is not lacked in anything illa shanahu, except it leaves that thing deformed. It's natural. And then she was protecting of a man. And it was the man. But, so now one Arab came there to Yemen, and he saw this thing that was being built, and the structure and all, and then he inquired as to what is the intention behind this thing. She said, "Name Diman, Abraha was his name. He's the governor here. He's strategizing. He wants to draw the Arabs to this place, and he wants people to ignore the Kaaba." So what that Arab did, in Islam, books of history, Hajjah, this hot-blooded Arab, he went into this structure one night and he relieved himself in it. And not only that, the fool, early morning, he bragged that he did that and then he left. So he said, it was me.
brag about it. Daar denk van jullie nou dan is. I can never be as sanctified as and holy as the Kaaba by us. Ik kan eigenlijk gebruik voor de toilet. So what happened was this now was the. This is what Abra was looking for. And he then said, if that's the case, we're going to go now to your area and we're going to destroy that structure. And we yell the elephants. It's called the year of the Amul Fil, the year of the elephant. And our books actually say that only he had the elephant. But Allah Alam, there may be others. And but surprisingly, other thing is this, we have a record of the name of that elephant. And we also have a record of the fact that that elephant refused, when he came to the border of Makkah, refused to enter. Went down and said, and elephants are intelligent, eh? Nah. And when they steered it in a different direction, they pushed it, and then it stood up and wanted to move and to pull it, rein it back. And when they turned it in the direction of the Kaaba, it sat. You don't want to go in the direction of Makkah, he didn't want to proceed. His name was Mahmud. And then last week, we don't want to spend too much time with it. Last week, what did we say? We said that Abdul Muttalib, whose name was Shaiba, yes, he came, he had scouts, and the scouts informed him that Abra is there. But Abra has taken camp, he has encamped outside of Makkah in an area where your camels graze. So he went there, Abdul Muttalib went there, and he wanted to be given a show, opportunity to address Abra. And Abra thought he was coming to negotiate. I mentioned this, right? Then he said, no, come to what? Come to speak about my camels. I want you to release my camels. So Abra then said, but you have fallen in my eyes. You've dropped in my eyes. I thought you were coming here to negotiate about your city, Makkah, and the structure there. Come to speak about camels. So Abdul Muttalib said, I am the owner of those camels. I care for them. And that lord, that house has a lord that cares for it. Inna lil bayt rabban yahmi. Okay? So when he returned, when Abdul Muttalib returned with his camels and returned into Makkah, his fellow chieftains asked him, what is the plan? He said, no, we cannot respond. There is the khruat and they have an elephant, etc. We have to pray. And early morning we leave for the hills of Makkah and we observe from there as to what's to happen to them. And that's, they say, Abdul Muttalib and the others, they went and hanged on the clit of the Kaaba and they prayed the night. And early morning they went out to the hillocks and then they observed from there and they were obviously safe. And they observed. Some say the birds came in from the seaside. And the sea is now Red Sea, the Jidda side now. And they have some descriptions. Where they get the descriptions? Allahu A'lam. But they say the birds had three stones. One in its beak, and two in the claws, one in each claw, etc. And some people died immediately. Others like Abraha were injured, and on the way back to Sana'a, on the way back to Yemen, Abraha died. So that's why the incident is, or the year is called the year of the elephant. And one significant thing, Hajjah, is that we understand why some scholars would say, not only did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send those birds to defeat that army, to save his house, but also to maintain and preserve the honor of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that was to be born in that year. Some say he was born about 40 days after the incident. Not long after. Some say a bit longer. In that time. Why would they say that not only did Allah send the birds to protect the Kaaba, but to preserve the honor of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Why would they say that he wasn't even born yet? Why? Because had Abraha and his army taken charge of the region and the city, then they would have enslaved its people. And whoever was to be born, would be born into slavery. And as a result of what Allah had sent, and the chapter you know, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ You know, Allah said at the end there, Allah said, He sent the birds, but at the end He made them, جَعْلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ. He made them like eaten stalks. Now, scattered like that. Okay. The honor of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. When and where did the Prophet's father die? The Prophet's father, Abdullah, was on trade. And to Sham. This is what our book says, Hajar. And he was now settled in Mecca. The Amina was there. He was on trade. She was still pregnant. Right? And he became ill on his way back from this one journey. Abdullah became ill. And Yathrib. So he decided to convalesce there, try to rest there, regain his strength and his health before moving down to Makkah. But unfortunately, he passed away there. So he passed away in Yathrib, Abdullah. So another question. She is now there in Mecca. The rest of her family, Amina's family, was in Medina. Amina, what is her father's name? Aminatu bintu Wahab. Well, I gave the name last week, Wahab. And I said in Cape Town, it's not a common name, but the female version might have been common before. And I know one person in Cape Town who still has that name. We may have said it differently. So Amina, her father's name was Wahab. And the female version is just Wahba. Okay? He had passed away. He passed on. And his brother's name was Wuhayb. So Amina's uncle. He had taken care of her, and he was, actually they say, her father passed away even before she got married. So when Abdul Muttalib went to ask for her hand in marriage for his son Abdullah, it was the uncle that he had to deal with. But that's all extra information. Don't have to worry about that information, Hajar. It won't come in the exam, don't worry. Then, so Amina is in Mecca, and Abdul Muttalib, the grandfather, he's now caring for her, etc. Okay? Nabi Sallam's grandfather, meaning her father-in-law. She had some individuals who supported her. And then right afterwards, she mentioned that when she gave birth, she saw something. Some say it was a dream, but some say it was in the waking, inshallah. Lit up, but I could see in the distance. I could see like the palaces of Sham. I could see like the lands of far off lands that she had not. She had not exited the lands of Arabia before, that we know of. She had not seen that before this incident. Things were shown to her and she, you know, had this feeling, these are these places. And someone was with her. There was a lady by the name of Thuwayba with her. Thuwayba. Thuwayba. Thuwayba means a small reward. It's again on the same scale. Can you see? Quraysh, Zubaydah, same scale. Thuwayba is from Thawab. It's for the Arabic students. She was a female slave of Abu Lahab. Abu Lahab. Now who was Abu Lahab? He's Abdullah's brother. Prophet Muhammad's paternal uncle. His name was Abdul Uzza, they say. But Abu Lahab was known as the father of a flame. Speaking maybe of his manner, he was a flammachi. Hot-blooded. Anyway, Thuwaiba was the slave, female slave of Abu Lahab. She was assisting Sayyidah Amina. And when Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born and things were settled, she rushed to Abu Lahab to give him the good news of his nephew. Your brother's wife, your brother had passed on, his wife gave birth to a son, and then he did something. He pointed with his thumb. Now when the Arabs do this for their slaves, it was a what? A decision that they'd taken to set that slave free. And we also thumbs up, some say it was like this down, sideways. Meaning you set free. He brought the glad tidings. Now the Arabs were like that before. And we'll hear about this if we get a chance to speak about certain Sahaba, like Ka'ab bin Malik. Ka'ab bin Malik, he at a point had not accompanied Rasulullah and the Sahaba on an expedition, Tabuk. And the message that Nabi delivered from Allah was that he, Ka'ab bin Malik, and two of his companions who had not been with us, Allah says, we should not speak with them for 40 days. It's about repentance, it's about... But when the glad tidings finally came after 50 days, that Allah had accepted their tawbah, the first person to bring him the news, Ka'ab says, I was sitting on the roof of my house. After the Fajr prayer, waiting for sunrise, alone, because no one was speaking with him. First person to bring me the news, near to me, I was looking for something to give him, I couldn't find anything, so I took my shirt off and gave it to him. They were like that. You bring them good news, they want to give you something. The bearer of the news, now. So when Thuwaiba came with the news that Sayyidah Amina had given birth to a boy, he, with a slave master, set her free. And then there's narrations that he was seen after he died. And you find this in Bukhari and the commentary by Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani. He was seen by one of his family members after he died. Now he died a strange death. He died almost like a solo epidemic. He passed away alone in his house. And then he started stinking. And his sons, Utbah and Utaybah, they took about 3-4 days before they got some slaves with sticks to push his body out. They didn't want to touch his body. And then they buried him in a ditch somewhere and threw sand on him. He was seen afterwards by his family in a dream. And you looked distraught. They asked him, what's your condition like? He said, bad. Except on a Monday. For a brief period, when you experience Mondays, because there's no time for them. When you experience Mondays, then there's a little liquid that I can suck from my thumb. That gives me a little bit of relief. This is there. So it's in the dream. Allah Alam is not proof. But this has been passed on and is documented in the commentary of Sahih al-Bukhari. But Imam Ibn Hajar was a grand scholar of hadith and he used to try to authenticate things. You know this there. Simply because Abu Lahab showed joy in the birth of Rasulullah and set his slave free, he's punished, but Allah grants him some relief. Whenever there's a Monday, and the Monday was the day when Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was born. That's why I don't like saying it's a blue Monday. No. I don't like saying it. I say we love Mondays because Monday is the day Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was born in. It's always a bright Monday. It's always a joyful Monday. Okay. There is something though. She did not just leave, because if you're born into slavery, you don't know any other life, Hajjah. So she hanged around in the area. And she got married. And she got pregnant. And she had milk. And she's also known before Halima to nurse Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And not only that, there's others also who come to them who she nursed, and as a result, they have some milk relation with Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Thuwaiba. And on that note, we have to end with this. Why did the Arabs send their children out. Is it protection? No? Purity? No? Language? Just yesterday I received a document from my daughter's school, and it's titled Why Kids Should Spend Time Out in Nature, especially millennials, especially nowadays. Because what we're doing, we may have access to the world via our palms and our tablets and our screens, access to the world, but we're not really out there. It's just in our, yeah. And the amount of strain and tension and heightened levels of concentration it requires gives us stress. Whereas out there, Allah has made it such, we are from the earth and we are to return to the earth. When we connect with the earth, we are in a more free, calm and peaceful state now. So we're not saying become tree huggers, but we are saying, firstly, beyond that, Allah wants us to look at nature. Allah wants us to ponder and see His power and grandeur in it. And every leaf is designed by Him. Every grain, now. And nothing occurs or moves or drops or falls except by His permission. That's one. Secondly, the added benefits is that we are reconnecting with ourselves. And that we find more solace and peace. And then we are influenced by color and shapes and forms. There's color therapy. So you see it on the screen, you can say, but it's not the real thing. There's a difference with the real thing because on here it's visual. There it's visual, but it's covering all your senses. You're hearing, you're smelling, now then you can taste a thing or two, etc. You know, it's activating much more than just the visual and your mind. So so lots of benefits, and that's why they sin. And they knew from their forefathers why. Firstly, they survived and they thrived in the desert Hajjah. Survived and thrived. But the desert life was, in a way, at times good for them because of the open, pure air and the open expanse. How do you feel if you must sit in a smaller masjid? You go to certain masajid, I'm going to mention like a masjid name, Garlandale Masjid, there's a certain area. They needed that upstairs, man. So, but now it resulted in the ceiling. The bottom, lowering. Now, you are yourself, but you're affected by your surroundings. Now, it affects you. How you feel in a small space, how you feel with certain colors. You get, color therapy is real. Now, or why do policemen wear blue? Because blue is a color of trust. Now, why lots of eating places have red? Besides red being a color of danger, red is also a color. If you see it a lot, it creates appetite. It develops your appetite, Haja. That's why I don't say, but you can. I'm not gonna say any brand names here. But you can think something starting with an M, something starting with a C, something starting with a K. I'm like something starting with an N, but it's by like why they have colors. Or the pasta for Esmos, Diana. The only drive-thru is there on the M5, Rajiv Park Center. The N of pasta for S. Red. We're affected by colors. Green, in the color spectrum, green is right in the center. It's neutral. Green is in the center. It's neutral. Black is the color of mystery. Mystery. Anyway. So why are they? Think about it. Why they send them to the outskirts? So the Arabs were used to that. They then developed cities. And then they changed. So they wanted their kids to draw from what they knew. They wanted their kids to draw from what they were. They wanted their kids to have a start like they had. But to grow up in the cities. Hustle and bustle. Allah bless. Barakah in our time. We see you next week, inshallah. صلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين والسلام على المرسلين وكل ذلك السلام عليكم.
لا إله إلا الله. إلا الله.